La emisión está comenzando. Todos los asistentes están en modo de solo escucha.
Good afternoon, good evening, good morning. Welcome to all of you who are on the other side. Specially mention deserves our audience from PNI Madrid chapter and also our only chapters in Latin America, Buenos Aires, Nuevo Cuyo, Montevideo, Cajamarca, Santa Cruz, and Asunción. You also want to welcome the remaining chapters in Latin America invited to this presentation and of you who are listening from Spain and from any corner of the world. We appreciate your interest and assistance. I am Rafa Pagan, a volunteer at the webinars area, and together with our area manager, Jesus Vázquez, and our fellows, José Baratón, Infa Muñoz, and Eva Vecino, we are pleased to present the interesting presentation of Luigi Telesca, How Blockchain and Smart Contracts Will Change the Way We Manage Contracts. First of all, many thanks, Luigi and Pablo, for your cooperation and for sharing your experience and knowledge with the subject as you present today. We are now registered 215 attendees to the presentation from different countries. Thank you, all of you. In this paper, Luigi will explain us how smart contracts and blockchain technologies are changing the way we'll do business, the way we will manage our company and business relations, the way we'll negotiate our assets, and finally, how we will monitor all contract obligations. Also, Luigi will explain in detail how blockchain and smart contracts can innovate in the project management and the way we keep track of all contractual obligations, facilitating interactions among the digital and the physical work. We will also present the TrackKey framework for contract management and how smart contract can monitor and automate the payment of a conditional-based contract based on service-level agreement performance or a third-party service. Our speaker Luigi is the co-founder of CEO of TrackKey, an award-winning peer-to-peer contract negotiation and lifecycle management platform integrated in the blockchain, part of the Startup Bootcamp and Kickstart Accelerator. Luigi invested the last 17 years working on distributed system, enterprise software, e-negotiations, future internet architectures and protocols. In 2006, he created the first peer-to-peer negotiation system for small and medium enterprises called Open Negotiation Environment. That was a research project founded by the European Union in the program FPC6. That proved the possibility to run business negotiations in a peer-to-peer network before even the blockchain existed. This research work led to the creation of a product called EXRate, the company he founded in 2011 to commercialize one result of then TrackKey. Luigi started his career as founding the research and development manager of CreateNet, an international research center that he contributed to create in 2003 and that he successfully led as chief operating officer until the 2016 acquisition. I want to remember you that this webinar will give you a technical PDU. The report of this PDU achieved is under your responsibility. The technical PDU applies to all the certification you may hold. We'll send you an email with the necessary instructions for reporting this PDU and the corresponding code. You can ask your question on our platform using the question panel, and Luigi will be very pleased to answer all these questions at the end of his presentation. Soon, you will also have the webinar recording available on our YouTube channel, in which you can also access it from the chapter website. A few hours ago, Pablo informed us that his flight had a problem, so he will not be attending this lecture, and I'm going to do his presentation for him. The presentation that he wanted to give us is in Spanish, and he's going to introduce a little bit more about the International Association of Contract and Commercial Management, the information you may see on your screen. Comenzamos con la presentación de la IACCM, la International Association for Contract and Commercial Management. Es una asociación sin fines de ánimos de lucro, nacida en 1999 con la idea de mejorar la calidad de las relaciones comerciales entre organizaciones, tanto del sector privado como público, a través fundamentalmente de una gestión contractual profesional. En el sur de Europa y Latinoamérica, la IACCM está representada por Pablo Silota, nuestro gran amigo y compañero que hoy no ha podido estar aquí. que nos ha visitado varias veces, tanto de forma física en las instalaciones de Microsoft, dando ponencias para PMI Madrid, y también, como no, a través de ese canal de webinars en el cual hemos tenido el placer de estar con él en varias ocasiones. Vamos a continuar un poquito más. En nuestro entorno, podéis ver que la diapositiva hace mención a un cambio estructural en el entorno. Hoy actualmente negociamos diferentes modalidades contractuales de las que teníamos anteriormente hace 25 años. Mientras que en 1984 negociábamos contratos de compraventa de mercancías de ejecución instantánea, hoy en día nuestros contratos son sobre todo basados en servicios, es decir, en una ejecución continuada, lo que se traduce en una relación contractual no basada en un cambio spot, en un cambio actual, sino buscando una relación que perdure en el tiempo. Es este un cambio importante desde el punto de vista de la dinámica contractual, que también implica un challenge importante. Por eso hablamos del ciclo de vida del contrato y de la gestión a lo largo de lo que sería la integración en proyectos, por ejemplo. En la diapositiva 3, lo que nos viene a decir es que a partir de la celebración de un contrato entre varias partes, la vida del contrato depende de un buen seguimiento y una evaluación a cargo de un subject matter expert, de un experto en negociación contractual. Y dicho contrato debe ser visto como una herramienta económica que genera relaciones de valor y no como un arma legal. Esto es importante desde el punto de vista de considerar en nuestra gestión de proyectos. No hablamos o no deberíamos hablar de procurement como compras, sino hoy día el término que se utiliza es contract management. Está muy alineado a lo que Pablo nos viene indicando muchas veces. Tenemos que centrarnos en una relación a largo plazo, ¿no? Aquí aparece, por tanto, la figura no del jefe de compras, sino del gestor de contrato, el contract manager, que al igual que ocurre con el project manager, tiene todo un cuerpo de conocimiento y de buenas prácticas en el que puede basar su trabajo, ¿no? Este contract manager se ocupa precisamente del monitoreo, de la evaluación, de cotejar y de resolver problemas a lo largo de toda la relación contractual, que puede ser mucho más larga que la del propio proyecto. No olvidamos esto. En esta tarea confluyen varias disciplinas. Es, por tanto, un cuerpo de conocimiento, igual que la dirección de proyectos o análisis de negocio, complejo. Incluye el derecho, economía, ingeniería, compras, ventas. En los países del sur de Europa y Latinoamérica tiene una aplicación directa en la gestión de proyectos. De ahí la presencia de contactos periódicos entre la ISCM y PNI. De hecho, el cuerpo de conocimiento que maneja el Contract Manager certificado está completamente alineado con el estándar de PMI, y de ahí la importancia de la integración en el equipo de proyectos, ¿no? Os dejo la reflexión de que consideréis esto que estamos hablando con la gestión de compras actualmente que hacemos en los proyectos, y de ahí muchos de los problemas que tenemos en cuanto a relación contractual, ¿no? Por último, aquí os dejo los contactos de nuestro compañero Pablo Silota. Si alguno de vosotros quiere contactar con él, os encomiendo a ello. Es un magnífico profesional, un gran compañero. Entiende perfectamente el challenge que manejamos en la dirección de proyectos y os puede ayudar muchísimo a reforzar esa importante área que es la gestión de compras en los proyectos. Y ahora ya, sin más detenimiento, and now without further delay, I leave you in the company of Luigi Telesca and his paper How Blockchain and Smart Contract Will Change the Way We Manage Contracts Now, and hand it to our friend Luigi, the presentation. Luigi, as you want, please.
Hello, everybody. Hi, this is Luigi. I'm actually connecting from Italy today. And so the Latin population is all together today via this remote session. So first of all, let me thank you, the PMI chapter, for giving us this opportunity, and also Pablo Silota that created the connection. And the objective of this meeting and this webinar is to give you a little bit more of insight about smart contract and blockchain. And now actually this is going to change the way we are going to manage the relationship, the contract, and even the way we are going to manage all the post-contract activity during with the blockchain. So Let me tell you a little bit about me and Trakti. So we are a company dealing with contract management and commercial agreements. So we are a company negotiating better deals, and we are doing this with the technology of blockchain. Why we're doing this with the technology of blockchain? Because blockchain is going to change everything. The way we are going to manage contractor relation, the way we are going to manage our asset, the way we are going to establish long-term commercial agreement, and also how those will feed accountant system, accountancy system. And why? Because actually is an innovation that is providing the possibility to combine three things for the first time: the legal world, the financial world, and the project management world in some way. And that's the reason why I really like the opportunity to speak here, because we can actually try to understand the opportunities, but also the challenges that this technology is bringing here in this sector. As you can see in this graph, there are at the center two coins. Those are the Bitcoin and Ethereum tokens. And then on the sides, you see different elements. So the first one is a kind of project design infrastructure. You see a composable architecture on the right side. You see dependencies connected with those flow, and you see contract. And you also see many different points, and those points are nodes, like we are in our distributed organizations. So what the blockchain does is to put everything together in a unified framework where actually we are going to be able to trade, negotiate, manage relationship, values, and activities. So and why this is important? Because we see for the first time an evolution in the contracts that is very different from what we have been doing and experiences before. Contracts until now have been managed as a black box inside the organization, something that was in some way confined into the legal world, where actually legal were responsible for drafting those very long contracts in order to protect the organization and not to create win-win relationship. Because actually it was very difficult to connect the way the contracts were behaving with the way projects and humans were actually operating. And so the contracts were kept inside a drawer, until maybe there was not an issue coming up. And so then the people were taking those contracts back and try to understand, okay, what we can do now in order to avoid those kind of problems. So the construct from a legal point of view that they were there were pretty static, and the interpretation of the contract was done manually by importing those data in different contract lifecycle management system, translated in project management approaches, and in some way providing a different way of reality inside the organization. Now, all this is going to change. How? First of all, the contracts are becoming more and more a dynamic organism, a dynamic entity that is not anymore providing paper information and legal information, but actually is providing relational information among the different entities in the organization. And the other thing is that we are observing is that the full digitalization of the company is providing in the real-time data feeds that can actually be connected with some concept that we have not only in the project management tool but also in the contracting world, like for example a risk function and service level agreement can actually be fed by service automation technology. And this is because cloud services are developing and Internet of Things is becoming more and more embedded in our today's society. So the blockchain is going to become, is entering into the key game of the contract, like creating a kind of a network that is interconnecting the contract logic with the capability of interconnecting services, information and data in a dynamic workflow model that basically connects the wording of the contract with operational activity. And by doing that, we create the concept of intelligent contract. So contracts that actually can become not only smart, but actually can become even capable of self-adjusting in case, for example, and this is still a big challenge inside the community, we are going to be able to provide machine learning capability real time to those digital artifacts. So as you can see, everything is changing, and the contract we are going to play in this kind of environment a pivotal role. A pivotal role that is able to basically become a boundary object between discipline, between function within the organization, and is going to orchestrate the way we are going to work. And why we are so excited? Because the blockchain, differently from the other system, is a distributed ledger, is a distributed infrastructure that basically provides not different views and different, let's say, elements that are anyway connected with a single version of truth. That is anyway kept inside one unique operator. The blockchain is a distributed infrastructure that create for the possibility of every single node to maintain the same version of truth, and provide the possibility to run in a transparent, a seamless way, record transactions that actually all the node can agree with. So we are moving from a centralized ledger where actually there was the concept of a kind of mediated reality into a full distributed ledger where each single node have the same level of responsibility within the system. And these, as you can imagine, increase transparency because all the records are kept distributed so they cannot be manipulated. All the agreements connected with deliverable and achievement of a specific activities can actually be shared between counterparts. So this will avoid manipulation of knowledge and in some way will reduce the data and the barrier to entry to specific market. But how does it work? So we have this distributed network. There is a ledger that is distributed too, so every single node has this information, and then where the blockchain is coming. So the blockchain is coming because the ledger is built in a way that has blocks that are grouping transactions. And in each transaction, there is an information about the sender, the receiver, and the transaction type. Each of single transaction is encrypted and then is grouped in a block that is connected with the previous blocks. So in order to modify, for example, a record from a one block, you need to modify the entire chain. But since this chain is then duplicated in all the nodes, it's very difficult to modify, right? So now those are the basic concept of the blockchain. So the ledger is reconciliating data of transactions and reconciliating the information about sender, receiver, and the version of truth. So for example, you cannot spend two times the same coin and those type of information. But this is only one element. So this is the way information are recorded in the blockchain and transactions are recorded in the blockchain. And the security is given by the encryption of each single transaction, but also the hash of the header of the block. So that you can understand all those information are connected and link one to the other. But the other important element of the blockchain is the way we need to record the information. Because of course we receive many transactions and many different nodes can insert transactions in the blockchain. But how we are going to make sure that those transactions are real? This is done via what is called inside the blockchain a consensus mechanism. That means, okay, we need to agree on the way we need to record those transactions. Now, most of the blockchain, or at least the most famous blockchain, that is the Bitcoin blockchain, is a recording transaction based on a mechanism that is called proof of work. What does it mean? It means that a node, in order to record a transaction, has to prove that he has done some calculation activity that are very complex calculations, and that also make sure that this node cannot fake the result. And this is a way in order then to transmit the information into the other nodes and propagate this transaction into all the other ledger. And after that is done, this block that is created can actually be connected with the old blocks, and the transaction can actually be confirmed. Now, the consensus mechanism based on proof of work, that is this kind of complex puzzle that actually has to be solved, make sure that even if I don't know you, meaning even if I don't know the node that wants to add a transaction, mathematics is making sure that the information cannot be corrupted. So this kind of concept in blockchain is defined as trustless infrastructure. That means I don't need to know you in order to be sure that you're doing something good for the system. And this is because mathematics is governing the system itself. And this makes the platform very secure, but at the same time, it makes the capability to add a transaction inside the system a little bit slow, and also create another little problem, that is the energy consumption. Because in order to do this big complex mathematical calculation, machines are using a lot of computational resources that are ultimately consuming a lot of energy. That's the reason why new methods of consensus are emerging, like, for example, proof of stake, another method that will keep the same level of security, but will make sure that the number of transactions that actually can run on the system, and also the number of nodes that can actually register this information without consuming too much energy, can increase over time, maintaining the system stable. The important thing, anyway, we need to understand is that no one can actually add a transaction without having this kind of being part of this consensus mechanism. And these keep the system stable and secure and make sure that all the transactions are recorded accordingly. Now, the not only different consensus mechanisms, but also different approaches are in the blockchain. There are blockchains that are open and that have full access control. Everyone can join, that are fully distributed like Bitcoin and Ethereum. And there are other implementations that are more closed, like limited circle can only join. There is a kind of control entity or a catalyst that permits the joining of these of adding new nodes in this type of infrastructure. And these depend mostly from the use case scenarios. Now, some of, let's say, people that are very, let's say, correct from that point of view, they believe, I also believe that the best blockchains are the public blockchain because no one can actually fake the data inside the system. While if you keep the access closed or you keep limit some control, then you can still have the possibility to hack the system. But at the same time, there are specific businesses that by regulation, they cannot permit the possibility to enter everyone inside the infrastructure, like for example, in banking. In those cases, some different ways of blockchain can actually be considered. Although we still believe that the permissionless public blockchains are the best one. Now, those different methodology and different technologies, because again, the blockchain is a technology that can be implemented in different way, they also have different characteristics. Some characteristics easy to understand are, some of those are token, like Ethereum and Bitcoin, that are in this case, for those infrastructure, a way to give a price to the nodes that are doing those computation, that are working for the ecosystem and are registering those transactions. Those are the miners. The miners are paid in order to do those calculation. And because they are doing those calculation and because they are helping the community to grow, they receive an incentive mechanism that is the token, that is the Bitcoin. So every time someone is solving this puzzle, now, of course, you cannot have more than one entity solving the puzzle for every transaction. This is a price is given like a Bitcoin or like an Ethereum. But for there are other implementation, like for example, Hyperledger Fabric. In this case, you can have many blockchains, but those blockchains don't have tokens. Let's say, or better, the currency and tokens, they come via chain code, so they are not defined in the same way. Or like, for example, in Corda, you don't have at all token and currencies, because this is done in a different way and is done in a private network infrastructure. The other, for example, big characteristic that you can see that is different is that smart contracts are implemented in different ways in different networks. This creates a little bit of, let's say, non-integration capabilities between those networks, because the language is different, the approach is different, but the first one that actually has done smart contract implementation has been Ethereum. So in some way, Hyperledger Fabric has been learning and creating some smart contract code also in its network by learning how to do it from Ethereum. The point is that smart contracts are the next level, and this is what we want to focus on, because now we understand blockchain, that is the basic infrastructure where actually not a registering transaction, but now we need to understand what it is a smart contract and smart contract code. Now, as you can see in Ethereum, the smart contract is codified in a language that is called Solidity, while, for example, in Hyperledger Fabric, this is done in Go or Java. So the different languages can actually be used in order to implement. It's not done in natural language, so that you still need a developer in order to translate those kind of commands, contract commands, inside a logic of a smart contract. Now, the blockchain, as I told you, is done in this way. You have a blockchain layer that is the basic infrastructure. There is, on top of that, there is storage content, and there is the possibility to create derivative chains. And some blockchain, they also consider the smart contracts as a layer where actually people can codify contracts that are leveraging on rules, workflow, and data we will see later, in order to process certain activities. Each blockchain has this shared data layer that is among, let's say, where all those orange parts, they need to be consistent, so they need to share the same data structure. On top of that, then you can have the decentralized protocol, so protocol that are doing specific activities, services, application, like, for example, you can register certificates, you can do social, let's say, social networking, you can register identity. All those have specific decentralized logic, like instead of developing your mobile app that is responding to a specific logic in a specific server, has to use distributed resources and then can expose what is called dApps, so that is the user interaction, the UI of the system. So this is the way the blockchain stack is composed. And now what we want to understand is a little bit more about the smart contract. So, but first of all, what it is a smart contract? Is a smart contract a contract or is something else? And this is a little bit, I like to show this picture done from Magritte that was questioning the same. Is a painting a painting of a pipe or is it something else? I think this is the question that everyone is asking about blockchain, a smart contract. Because is the smart contract a real contract or is it just a representation of a contract? I think this is not the right way of seeing the future coming. I think we need to represent and understand that the smart contracts are effectively contracts, but are codified in a different way. And we also need to remember that the smart contracts in some way have been around us since the beginning of digitalization. Now, for example, a vending machine was the first smart contract that we had. And it was the only difference with the smart contract in the blockchain is that it was not distributed. The logic of a contract was embedded in the hardware of a specific vending machine. And every time we were putting tokens, we were receiving something else without signing a contract with a paper, but actually receiving the logic of exchange of values, and the workflow was embedded in the logic of the system. Now, with the smart contract, we can do something more. So we can consider that these value, this infrastructure can be shared with millions of vending machines, and the contract can actually be exactly the same, but the value we can exchange through those vending machines can actually be agreed between all those systems. So the first guy that actually defined what it is as a smart contract has been Nick Szabo. This was done in 1996. Before the definition and the creation of the first, let's say, blockchain infrastructure, there was a, let's say, commercial and I will say successful blockchain attempt that was, that is Bitcoin. And as you can see here, what he's saying, Szabo, is saying that smart contract go beyond the vending machine in proposing to embed contracts in all sorts of property that is valuable and controlled by digital means. So the first thing that you can see here is that the concept of property is can be represented by a smart contract. And the way to control this property can be done by digital means. And then what he says is that in this way, the property, the concept of the property can become dynamic and proactive and can provide much better observation and verification mechanism than the physical one, okay? So what he was envisioning was a way to actually digitalize the value of an asset that is physical into a virtual form, in a digital self, and provide the possibility to encode the rules connected with those properties into an object that is a smart contract that can also provide dynamic monitoring of those assets. Not only transferring will be simpler, but also other things, like, for example, more social behaviors, like, for example, my house can actually be tokenized. And instead of buying only the bricks, I can actually provide my house as a service. So all the people that can actually have tokens of my house can use it for a period of time, and maybe they can create a new business model on top of it. And that brings us to identify the major difference between a contract and a smart contract. So a contract is a traditional agreement done between two or more entities that is verbal text on paper, so, and is interpreted by humans or lawyers. So there is a concept of interpretation that is also connected with the fact that, I mean, this is called wet code in, let's say, in our world, and that this interpretation provides legally binding elements that anyway are flexible because I'm interpreted by humans. Okay? Now, what's the difference between a smart contract? A smart contract is a rule-based contract that executes like a vending machine, like is code, and is dry in the sense that cannot be interpreted, because is well defined, and is the code itself cannot be breached, and will proceed unstoppably if conditions have changed. So as you can see, there is a big difference between the two things, the difference is that the contract can also monitor itself, while the first version is subject to interpretation, because the interpretation can be many. While in the smart contract, you have a well-defined approach. Of course, you can program it in a different way in order to also create the possibility to have some mitigation mechanism, but at the same time, the contract is able to self-execute. And what we need to understand is that the smart contract cannot live without, and this is my take here, the smart contract is going not to live alone, or maybe we'll live in the future, but not today, where we, as a society, we are used to have wet code everywhere. So what we are doing and what we are working in the community, especially in the legal community, is to connect the wet code to the smart contract code via Ricardian contract. And what does it mean? So we have a PDF Word document that is a template. With the help of the computer science, we basically parameterize and we insert in the pros some base type parameters that then are connected with external sources, with internal logic, with different elements that those pros linked to higher order parameters can then be connected with the business logic of the smart contract, and creating a continuum space from the definition of the let's say legal word into the definition of what can actually be negotiated during a phase, and so it can actually provide an initial level of logic into a full execution of the contract after it has been signed. And the smart contract itself, what it's providing is information about who is buying what, which values is in transfer, how to make sure that the person is transferring balance between the two entities, defining a deadline for a specific activities, and put a conditional logic in case transfer of money and value is happening, so that, for example, not only the money is transferred, but also the transfer, the asset ownership is also transferred. And in fact, in the smart contract, what do we have are data that can be input data, permission level, workflow activities, and token transfer. Now, why this is relevant for you is that the concept of workflow activities can actually be connected with a project management capability. So in some way, by codifying in the contract part of the project management stuff, you can actually make sure that there is a kind of a feed and control function in the contract that you don't have to outsource into other tools. Now, this can create the link between project management and accounting and contract management in a unique integrated framework. For example, in our system, how we use it. So in our system, you can create a commercial contract, a commercial agreement with a counterpart, right? So you need to configure the deal. And so what you do, basically, you can process and upload your contract templates inside our system or your clauses, and then you can model those clauses and create a way to connect those with the smart contract, all in a single infrastructure. Then this meta contract can actually be negotiated with the counterpart. So we can provide the entire support for negotiation, and the negotiation is feeding then the input value of the Ricardian contract, the one that you see in the middle. As soon as those values are agreed, the contract is notarized in the blockchain in order to become immutable, and a derivative smart contract is released in order to monitor the execution of what has been agreed during the negotiation. That is basically the contract. We generate three type of contracts. The legal version, that is the one that has been signed and is fully compliant with the registration. The Ricardian contract, that is the one that actually is connected with the legal version. And the smart contract, that is basically released as a monitor system for the implementation of the reality. So what is happening during the negotiation, during the setup, you basically create this element, this contract. You define in which network has to run, in which blockchain infrastructure has to run. Then you start negotiating with the counterpart. As soon as you reach an agreement, the smart contract is released. The smart contract is responding, is mimicking the implementation value of the contract you have been agreeing. Some of the parameters are transferred in order to give input to the workflow. And then the blockchain is starting running those smart contracts in a distributed fashion, so in order to control the activities that have to be done among the parties. As soon as the rules are defined and agreed, the system is also checking if there is if the outputs are aligned with what has been agreed during the negotiation phase, and start transferring value and economic transaction that actually is connected with the original contract. The implementation and the opportunity that blockchain, as you can see, are pretty wide. So blockchain and actually smart contract can be embedded in different markets. Of course, doesn't make any sense to implement a blockchain and a smart contract infrastructure if the system is not distributed, or if what we want to do is just to, let's say, create a transferring from a centralized database in a distributed database just to say that is a blockchain-driven infrastructure. It makes sense when you want to maintain an ecosystem and you want to give the ecosystem the possibility to cross-contaminate and create a distributed application. And as you can see, the first sector that are applying are the financial sectors, the supply chain infrastructure, some legal system, real estate, property management, music management, all those systems that actually have the possibility to maintain asset distributed and transfer value and monitor contract in a distributed fashion. In banking and financial services, we have been working a lot on cross-border payments, trade finance, KYC, and also event-driven securities and insurance. But this is just the tip of the iceberg, because there are many other use cases that actually can come. And we are, let's say, in the process to create new products for distributed communities. Another scenario of application for you to think about is the one of the supply chain, where you have many different parties that are involved. And at the moment, the communication and the contracts that they use is really very inefficient, because there are way so many, too many contracts, a lot of paper flowing within those network, and the way to control the contract execution is done in different way for different subsystems. And this basically creates a lot of problem, not only in transferring values, but also controlling the compliance. So in this case, a smart contract will maintain the possibility for each organization to be independent, but interface on a common infrastructure and running smart contracts for specific products and services that are agreed among those players. The smart contract in that case will be the orchestrator of the relationship between the counterparts, and also, of course, can be one or many smart contracts, but and also the smart contract will run the capability to make sure that actually the execution is done in compliance with what has been agreed during the negotiation and contract management phase. I'm done with the presentation. You can have the possibility to see a demo of Tract if you want by registering into one of those meeting and events. What I want to show you is just in the meantime that we collect some questions from your side. I can show you a little bit the system, especially the way you connect a smart contract with a Ricardian and wet contract, because this is important for you to understand the way the system is drafted. So in our platform, as I told you, you can have models that basically you can take from your contracts that you are already running in your organization, like in this case. As you can see, this is a contract that has been imported by a Word document. And as you can see here, is a full document that has been defined in our system. And in the Ricardian way, you can actually create variables. And those variables can actually be connected with many different elements, like, for example, formula, data feeds, and information. And those can actually be even connected among them. But the most important thing that you can see is that we can also hide in our system a smart contract that is a source code, as I was explaining to you, that is defining values, state, it defines specific logic that can be connected with some variables. So we have in this demo infrastructure, we have several of those, like single payment, recurrent payment, conditional payment, security bond, fixed deposit. In this case, those elements are then embedded in the logic of the system, as you can see here. And the smart contract is released and connected with the original version of the contract. We have signature, we have KYC fields. So what does it mean? When the contract is running, I can actually see that there has been a transaction. There has been a transaction, and this transaction is actually part of a sequence of activities that has been agreed. So this is the contract that we agreed, that has been certified in the blockchain. So this is, for example, a transaction record inside the blockchain. So this is a contract that has been certified inside the blockchain and has released as a smart contract, as you can see here, that is basically starting acting in order to control the activities of and implementation of the contract. In this specific logic, the contract model itself is executing the logic of SLA monitoring. So in the, for example, we have been outsourcing a customer service and we want to make sure that the customer service is doing its job. So we control the system of ticketing in order to see that the parameters are the one agreed. If they are the one agreed, the system is going to give a bonus. If they are performing above the threshold we agreed, they are going to receive a bonus. If they are going to perform below, they are going to receive a penalty. And this information is recorded in the logic of the contract. So that basically the back office of the contract can actually be done by the contract itself. And this version is not just done by one party, but it's done in a distributed fashion. So what does it mean? No one can actually change the contract from one way point of view. And also, the records are registered and maintained in the system autonomously. That's what I wanted to show you. Thank you very much. If you have any question, this is the right time.
Thank you very much, Luigi. This is a fantastic presentation, full interesting. I think you have just pointed out some of the utility of blockchain. That's fantastic. Future is coming, is there. How we use it depends on what you think you may, maybe in terms of credibility, but it's a fantastic time to do the questioning. Okay, but before questioning you, let me invite you not only to attend this webinar as you have just done, as an audience, but also as a potential speaker. If you have an idea or some interesting topic for our community of project managers, you will be very welcome as a speaker, as the way Luigi did today. I'm going to send you my email details just in case you want to contact me and tell me about some potential lecture you may be interested in presenting here. Now we go with the first question. Luigi, this for you comes from Maria Teresa Bellino, and she talks about how can anyone exchange the contract in the blockchain? Is that easily done? How can we amend the contract if that is the case? How can we do that, if possible? Luigi, are you there?
Sorry, I was on mute. So the smart contract can actually be seen by everyone that is part of the community, because it has to be deployed on all the nodes that are part of the transaction. This contract is visible, is public, can actually be controlled. Also from due diligence point of view, this makes things transparent. The contract that is the contract among the parties, this one cannot be seen because, for example, in our case, is shielded. But we provide a verification mechanism in order to make sure that this contract is verified, so that is real and is not a fake contract. Regarding the conditions, I think she's referring to, there is the possibility to modify the business logic. This is done with a specific approach, but it's very complicated at this stage. So you can amend the contract, only with the consent of all the parties involved, because of course an amended version of the contract has to be agreed among the parties. So there is a way to amend the contract. In case you want to stop a specific contract, there are methods. The smart contract itself cannot be stopped. What it can be done can be made useless in some way. So we can make sure that actually the contract running is not breaking any law or agreement, but you basically transfer from one contract type into another one.
Okay, excellent. Let's go with another question. Lidman Ordóñez makes you the following question. Is there any experience of blockchain application to any health project? Do you know any of those applications to the health sector, Luigi?
Yes, there are. I think there are already some public hospitals that are experimenting. I don't think it is still commercially available, but that are experimenting this kind of concept. Of course, the problem there is mostly connected with the privacy of data. That's the reason why some of those are running private or permissioned blockchain that also have data access capability, but they are not running for sure on public blockchain so far.
Okay, excellent. I'll do my question by myself, Luigi, and very much interesting on, are you seeing any integration with this blockchain smart contract technology with controlling the access to a device, something that has been the object of a contract? in a physical way, in a physical interaction with the Internet of Things?
Yes, this is something that we are working also on because we are maintaining asset of, let's say, valuable asset, I have to say. It is done, the integration is done in two ways. The first one is data. Let's say we can receive from an access, a gateway, information about the records, but we can also give authorization to a gateway, to a system, basically to access a specific area based on the blockchain credential, because blockchain, the blockchain identity can be seen as a identity of a user, if you want. So what it is, a wallet, that is the way you manage your identity, can actually be used for access control mechanism. There is a smart contract company. The smart contract, of course, is managing the access control. There is a smart contract company that, for example, has been doing it for property, is called Slockit. You can have a look. It's an interesting example on how to do this for property management.
Excellent, Luigi. I have found a lot of clients that they are very much interested on assessing any potential application of this blockchain technology to contract. If that is the case, could anyone get in contact with you and have an assessment of the potential applicability of your services? Could be that possible?
Let's say what we do, as you probably see, we sell we provide our framework. I think I can provide some. I mean, if it is something very different from what we are doing, it's very difficult for me to give you feedback. But of course, yes, you see my email and my phone number. So if you want to contact me, you're more than welcome to do so.
Okay, that's excellent. And with this last answer of Luigi Telesca ends our webinar, this incredible webinar in terms of updated technology used today as a potential application to our smart contracts application in project management. Thank you again, Luigi. I remind you with that, with your assistance to this webinar, you will obtain one technical PDU, and we will send you an email with all the corresponding instructions to get it. Again, thanks to all the attendees, and especially to Luigi, and also our friend that hasn't been able to have this webinar with us, Pablo Silota. Thank you for sharing your knowledge in this great presentation. And I want you also to take advantage of the time to invite you to our next December webinar. It will be on the 30th of December. We will enjoy the interesting presentation by Marta Telles titled El éxito en el desarrollo de proyectos de business intelligence en las organizaciones. This webinar will be in Spanish as usual. We're waiting for you next December 13th. Best regards. Thank you again for all of you. I hope we met again, Luigi and Pablo. Thank you very much. Kind regard.
Thank you, Rafa, and thank you to PMI for giving this opportunity.
You have thank a you. House here. This is your house. Thank you very much. All of you have a good time. See you next webinar. Goodbye. Thank you.